Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our Zoom service. We are continuing to experiment to improve the sound and quality of our service. We had a lot of trouble last week, of course, with the video, the garbledness of the audio. So we've pre-recorded some elements of the service, and we're going to play those and let us know what you think. You can join us for worship, of course, as you are now, Sundays at 9 a.m. on Zoom. Or Facebook. I better start the Facebook here in a second. And every Monday through Thursday at noon. And we have a pre-recorded service on YouTube that drops every Saturday. This week is the beginning of Lent. We have a service on Ash Wednesday at noon on this same bat channel, same Zoom link. It'll be a live service on Zoom. You should have received or will be receiving, we hope, a packet with ashes that have been blessed, which you can apply yourself to you and your family. Also a little service, which you can follow along or do yourself if you can't be with us at noon. We're also gonna record that service. And so you can watch it on YouTube later and participate that way. And in the packet, there's also a daily devotional guide for Lent. We have a lot of programs for Lent this year, which we'll be offering virtually. One is phone a friend. This is an opportunity to connect with someone, a fellow parishioner. We're gonna randomly assign people. If you wanna opt out, please let us know ASAP, otherwise you will get assigned to a random parishioner. And the idea is that you would make contact and pray for this person once a week during Lent. So it could be a text, an email, a phone call, But the idea is to, while we feel so separated, to connect with one another in this community of faith. Virginia Higgins has written a lovely little article in the Epistle about a practice she's been doing for a number of years called the God Box. It's a way of, one, being accountable for your Lenten resolutions, and two, using that accountability to support a local charity. And so, the idea is that if you take on something or give up something for Lent, every day that you're successful, you put whatever monetary amount you designate into your own little God box, whatever that could be, an envelope, could be a box. We have a picture of Virginia's box. And if you're not successful that day, you double it. And so if it's a dime or a quarter or a dollar or $100, whatever your amount is, at the end of Lent on Easter, we'll collect all of those God boxes and make what we hope is a sizable donation to Neighborhood House. We are also having a Lenten class on Thursday nights, not this Thursday, but starting a week from Thursday, which I believe, I'm just doing this from memory, Father John can correct me, but from Ashes to Hope, I think something like that. And it's going to be hopefully a really helpful part of your Lenten journey that's on Zoom on Thursday nights. Watch the Epistle for the link for that. And then Ann Weber, the Reverend Ann Weber, has put together a number of wonderful resources for your own spiritual practices, which you can find on a webpage that we've created, stpfeeds.org/Lent. So check that out for lots of ideas for Lent. For this service, we invite you to stay muted unless you are speaking. If you are reading or doing another part of the service, please do unmute yourself for that. Without further ado, we will continue. Let's just take a second to center ourselves. And I should say, if you're visiting with us, we're really glad you're here. And we hope one day that we can connect with you in person. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The reading today is from 2 Kings 2, verses 1 through 12. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood some distance from them, as they were both standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle, rolled it up, and struck the water. The water was parted to one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." And he responded, "You've asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am been taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of the fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended into a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. The word of the Lord. The Lord, the God of gods, has spoken. He has called the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, perfect in its beauty, God reveals himself in glory. Our God will come and will not keep silence. Before him, there is a consuming flame, and around about him, a raging storm. He calls the heavens and the earth from above to witness the judgment of his people. Gather before me, my loyal followers, those who have made a covenant with me and sealed it with sacrifices. Let the heavens declare the rightness of his call. for God himself it is judged.
Our second reading today is from 2 Corinthians. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus Christ. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who shines in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
Jesus is the same. The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He didn't know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy Valentine's Day. Today is the day when we celebrate romantic love. There can be, however, a pressure to have someone or to feel a certain way, to strive, if you're a certain generation, for Instagrammable perfection in your romantic relationships. The burst of romantic love at the beginning of a relationship is wonderful. It's fantastic. But we know if we've been married a long time or been in a long-term relationship that you can't sustain that same intensity that you have at the beginning. That intensity, that burst of romantic love at the early stages of a relationship prepares us actually for the deeper and richer possibilities of a happy long-term relationship. Happy, but not at the same intensity. I don't think we could maintain that. Friendship, trust, shared experiences and memories, the good and the challenging, those are what endure, not the initial romantic feelings. They change. They don't disappear, but they change into something that is more long-lasting. Our gospel today is not about Valentine's Day, but I had to think about that because it describes what we might call a literal mountaintop experience. Peter and James and John, the sort of inner circle of the disciples, go with Jesus to the top of the mountain and witness his transfiguration. Transfiguration means a kind of changing or a revealing of something that was there. There's a lot of echoes in this story, echoes of Moses when he went up on Mount Sinai and came down with his face glowing so much that he had to wear a veil. In fact, Moses shows up in this story. He appears with Elijah on either side of Jesus. Those two figures, so important in Judaism. Moses, the representative of the law, you know, the one who brought the Ten Commandments down from Mount Sinai, the one who embodied that particular relationship, covenant relationship with God. And then Elijah, who is one of the greatest of all the prophets and represents for Jews of the first century and forever after that prophetic witness, the speaking for God, the law and the prophets, two of the great pillars of Judaism, are there with Jesus on this moment of revelation, this moment of glory. And just as at Jesus' baptism, God speaks, in case they hadn't gotten the message, "This is my son, the beloved," just like he said at the baptism. But now he adds, "Listen to him." clearly you guys have not been paying close enough attention. You need to listen. That mountaintop experience prepared Peter, James, and John for what was coming. Jesus had been predicting for some time his passion, his suffering, and his eventual death. He had said it three times at least, but they hadn't been able to really take it in. In fact, Peter had rebuked Jesus for saying that. And Jesus famously said, "Get behind me, Satan." That's why God had to say, listen to him. This glimpse of Jesus' glory is a preview, if you will, of the resurrection. And it is what will give them strength, these disciples, will give them strength when everything seems to be falling apart. We too face many challenges in this life, times of suffering and doubt, of worry and fear. And I think we too need mountaintop experiences, signs of God's glory and presence to carry us through these hard times. So today's a good time to think back on some of these experiences. When did you hear or feel or see God most clearly? What did that look like for you? What would you describe as a mountaintop experience? Was it a church service, taking communion, or perhaps a particularly inspiring piece of music? Was it on a hike outdoors, perhaps an actual literal mountaintop of your own, or somewhere else in nature when you were in awe of the grandeur of God's creation? Was it at a retreat or during a quiet time of prayer? Was it a joyful family reunion, or maybe it was being reconciled after a painful separation from a friend or a family member? I always think of the prodigal son story. That must have been a mountaintop experience for the prodigal son. For me, I can remember several events that I would consider mountaintop experiences, times when I felt exalted, caught up out of myself, almost in a different plane. For me, it happens most regularly when I'm singing. Once I was in a Welsh choir. It was a festival that used to be held every Labor Day weekend, and I was in a choir of 1,000 or more Welsh people belting out great Welsh hymns. We'll be singing, just sang a Welsh hymn, that kind of great music. That inspires me, and I would consider some of those moments mountaintop experiences. Or I remember singing in a choir with an orchestra, the Mozart Requiem, those exalted words and music that Mozart shared with us. Or I can remember visiting a dying parishioner, feeling so inadequate, I didn't know what to do or to say. And I felt God speak through me words that I could not have come up with on my own. That was amazing. These were times for me when I felt the veil between this world and the next seemed to pull back, to open up for just a moment. And I imagine that's what it was like for Peter and James and John on that first transfiguration. They wanted to preserve the moment. Peter, impetuous Peter, said, let's build booths for you. He didn't know what to do, but he wanted to sort of capture this amazing experience. And I think sometimes we're tempted too to want to capture these experiences, to stay on the mountaintop, as it were. I had to laugh during the Super Bowl. One of the commercials was for a new streaming service, Paramount Pictures, and they had all these characters climbing up the mountaintop. And when they got there, they said, "Now what? Do you stay up there?" No. The purpose of the mountaintop experience is not to just stay on the mountaintop, to keep looking for that spiritual high, that fix, I think people can get kind of hooked on that, almost addicted to it, and want that more and more. But that's not what it's for. These moments, these glimpses of the glory of God, like the time when Peter and James and John saw Jesus transfigured, they are to give us strength so that we can go back down the mountain, back into the valley, back into real life with all of its hardships and struggles. Just as a healthy relationship cannot stay in Valentine's Day mode forever, so we too cannot stay on the mountaintop. We are called, like Jesus, like Peter and James and John, to come down again and to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. But we walk through that valley with our hearts still lifted up, our eyes still shining with the reflected light of God's glory. And if you're like me, with the echo of those great Welsh hymns or Mozart's Requiem resounding in your ears. As we approach Lent again, may we give thanks for the mountaintop experiences of our life. May we remember them and hold them in our hearts so that we may have strength to walk with Jesus down the mountain into the wilderness and into the ministry, the work, the life that God is preparing for us. And may we see in the mountaintop experience of transfiguration a foretaste of resurrection, of new life, of abundant life, of power and light and life and joy, which we anticipate and look forward to sharing one day in God's eternal and glorious reign forever and ever. Amen.
We join together in the affirmation of our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray to God, who is manifest in Jesus Christ. As the prophet Isaiah rang out, "Arise, shine, for your light has come." Empower your church, O God, to ring out the good news of the light of your Son, Jesus, which pierces even the deepest darkness. We pray especially for Michael, our presiding bishop, Bonnie, our bishop, Wendell and Stuart, our retired bishops, Eric, Ann, and John, our priests, Brianne in her year of discernment at EYSJ, for Lutheran bishops, Elizabeth, Donald, and Craig, for our diocesan household, remembering especially St. Paul's in Jackson and the Cathedral Church of St. Paul's in Detroit, and in the Dominican Republic, Moises, their bishop, that our worship and praise may give glory to God and our witness and ministry promote peace on earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As a star rose high into the nighttime sky to draw the nations to the Christ child, send your blessing, O God, on this nation and every nation, and draw the whole world to your peace and truth. We pray especially for Joe, our president, Gretchen, our governor, the Congress and the Supreme Court, and your local elected officials. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As John the Baptist guided throngs of people to the edge of the wilderness and baptized Jesus in the River Jordan, we pray that you would guide our country and our leaders to the ways of justice and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Like the Magi who traveled from afar to bring gifts and celebrate the Savior's birth, we pray for this community and for those who celebrate their own birthdays and anniversaries. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As Jesus climbed the mountaintop and proclaimed the blessings on the people of the world, we pray for the sick and the distressed, the poor and the lame. We pray especially for those on our prayer list: Carlton, Paul, James, Marge, Sarah, Elise, Kathy, Rose, Sylvia, Kim, Rad, Chris, Frank and B, Catherine, Gregory, Karen, Rob and Sue, Rebecca, Jan and Megan, and Ray, and those we name now, Sarah. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For first responders and those serving in the armed forces, especially Ryan, Trace, Stephanie, Dylan, Matthew, Ian, and Dan, and any others. Graham. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As Jesus called his disciples to leave their nets and boats and follow him, we pray for those we love and all those who have answered your call to follow Jesus to your heavenly kingdom, especially Lydia and those we name now. Give them your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, light of the world, hear our prayers and make us reflections of your light, that the places of darkness in our world can be pierced by your light, and that all nations would be drawn to you and be overwhelmed with joy. Amen.
We pray also for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries and this week. If you would like your birthday included, if it's not on our list, or your anniversary, do email Krista in the office. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, in you we live and move and have our being. Your love gives us life and sustains all of our relationships. Look with favor, we pray, on these your servants as they remember and celebrate all the anniversaries of their lives, including their birth, baptism, marriage, ordination, and others, especially this week, Sophia and Mary Jane. Sustain them with your bountiful spirit and grant them the grace to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart in this life and in the life to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. You can use the chat to say peace. Peace to everybody. Nice to see everybody on the screen. All right, back to our sharing here. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal Word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundation of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor are yours, creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time gather us with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Philip, all your saints, and all your people, into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise. Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God, holy gifts for holy people. Let us pray together in the words of the prayer for spiritual communion. In union, O Lord, with your faithful people at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, I desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. I remember your death, Lord Christ. I proclaim your resurrection. I await your coming in glory. Since I cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let me never be separated from you. May I live in you and you in me, in this life and in the life to come. Amen.
And now may Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Anne, do you want to unmute yourself and give us the dismissal? I just surprised her with that, so.
Okay. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and I didn't read the book.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sorry about that.